As we promised, we are back with day two, and our first lecture is with Ms. Purvi Shah Paolini. She will be presenting a topic on integral organizational development in connection with intercultural aspects. Now, we had a topic yesterday, bring life to life, and I think we are continuing our journey with Purvi, and this will be even more exciting, I must tell you, because Purvi, as a consultant, have a background in economics, is an integral, and cultural developer for people and organization. So for last 15 years, she's working relentlessly in Germany, and she also provides intercultural seminars, lectures, coachings, workshops for companies to bridge this cultural difference. And I think it's still more relevant in this, pandemic, and especially between European countries and India. She is fluent in her mother tongue, Gujarati, as well as German and English, and is aware of, Indian and German culture. She studies business administration at the Neuttingen-Geislingen University of Applied Science in Germany. After her studies, she worked as a project manager for an internationally active enterprise in Stuttgart, south of Germany. And currently, in her mode of work, she have described a situation where she has told in her book that it is not important to neutralize differences, but instead develop an understanding for mindsets. Look how important this statement is, out of which both parties can benefit. She is an author of German business book, which you all can, I hope you can buy, maybe Purvi can tell it in a minute, and which she wrote actually during her 15 years experience as a business developer with her sound marketing and sales know-how. So without any further ado, I welcome Ms. Purvi Shah Paolini to you all, gentlemen. The stage is all yours, Purvi.
Thank you very much for this wonderful introduction, Kuntal. And I'm very glad, and thank you very much for this invitation here at the Pharma Circuit, also to Mahua, Mario, and Utkarsha, and the whole team who is behind this wonderful event. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Good to have you here.
Yes, nice. Now, you told actually the most important things about me. I think the presentation can be seen. No? It's is all right.
Yeah, we can see that.
Wonderful.
Perfect.
Yeah, I think one more important thing is that both the parents are from India, and I was born and raised here in Germany only. So I went to a German school. I have done all my schooling in German. So I am actually from Stuttgart, but not right now. I am based here in North Rhine-Westphalia in Münster. It's a small town, let's say 1.5 hours away from Düsseldorf. And so people can locate that city here where I am. As you already mentioned, that I'm self-employed. I have my own business since 15 years. Till mid of 2020, I called my business Living India. So everything was connected to India. But I'm changing myself during that pandemic. I have also said to myself, let's seize the chance. And since 6 years, I'm involved in a project which is called One World, No Hunger, which was initiated by the German government to support. That is totally different to that what business actually is, but it's all about organizational development. This project supports farmers in Africa and India to get more professionalized. Now, they are already very professionalized, but to bring certain things in a structure so that their members have a better voice in their respective countries. So this is also where I'm very much into. That means the integral. I will explain to you the term integral a little bit more into detail. It's about integral organizational development, about cultural development, independently if it's a joint venture or cooperation with different countries. A company is always formed with its own culture, and therefore it's very important to know in which country am I, what are the different dimensions we have to look at when we build up or set up an entity somewhere in whatever form. I'm also very much into executive coaching and in business and in private, and executive development. I'm the author, as Kuntal already mentioned, of this book here. It's in German. It's called Chefsache Integral Business with India. It's my last 15, 20 years experience. My own upbringing was so Indian, and the German companies are really having an issue, and the other way around, the Indian companies having an issue in understanding these different cultural mindsets. And I have an advantage by, I have an invisible switch. I always tell myself that whenever I'm in India, I can switch and I'm totally Indian. And whenever I'm in Germany, I can be totally German. But what is in between? Yeah, so especially this is the most important questions when you have joint ventures, corporations, when Indo-German relationships are built up, how to get this mindset on a common ground. And I have initiated a podcast since last year. There are many episodes which you will find on my website, which is still called livingindia.de, is the Wisdom Workshop, where I'm very much interested in the Western and Eastern wisdoms that can be applied in business. That is very important, which I think is to be seen nowadays, that especially the pandemic, in my view, is just a small crisis. The bigger crisis going to get us is the climate crisis. And there is the question very often, how can we deal with that? And what new ideas do we need in order to have a sustainable life in the world? But now coming back to the business, let us get into the topic integral. This chart, integral, is initiated by a philosopher called Ken Wilber. He is in the US. And he formed the term equal. That means all quadrants, all lines, and all levels. If we look at an organization from a meta perspective, an organization exists of an interior, a subjective side, which is the left side, you can see the upper and the lower quadrant, and from an outside, everything what we can see from outside on an organization. Yeah, so we are looking at the from the meta perspective. We are right now not within the organization. We are looking at from outside at an organization. Then we have the individual part here, which has an interior and an exterior side, and the system, which is actually an organization, actually only exists when we look from inside, from the system side. That means we have an interior subjective part, and we have an exterior objective part, which forms the system. Now, when we look at any of your organizations, all the business people sitting here who work for an organization or who own a business, yeah, even starting from small like mine, I'm a one-woman show, up to big scale, big enterprises, multinationals, yeah, we have formed, or you or companies do have to form, a vision and values, conflict resolution systems, a V feeling, a communication, which is parallelly also backed up with the structure and processes and many, many more, with the surrounding, with the laws and everything which is surrounded by a company in order to sustain somewhere. So Germany has different laws maybe to set up a company than India, for example. Private, if you zoom in again, you have a private limited, is a difference than just having a maybe, I don't know, a joint venture where you just say, or you have a corporation where you have an agent. There you have total different law structures, and all that has to be looked at very thoroughly when starting a corporation. Now, all this is very much dependent. We can have all the value system, we can have all the V feeling, we can have a vision, a mission of a company that forms the purpose of your company, and the structure and the processes are supportive to fulfill this line. So if you work, for example, that's what I'm doing for very thoroughly with companies, and especially also with the organizations right now, with the farmers organization, if I say, you have already set up structures, processes, you have certain goals, towards what would you like them to go to? Have you already formed a vision? Have you already formed your values? How is your, if you have a conflict, how do you solve them? Do you have mechanism implemented? Sometimes, is there a big structure needed or not? Or does it already work the existing way as you do, and we don't need to set up a big organogram? So all these questions are being asked, and this, a company is only possible to exist if all the co-workers from top level to the production and the T-boy and whoever works there is committed to this vision, values of a company. And everything else can be seen outside here in actions as a client, as a person who is dealing, as a stakeholder who is dealing with this company. Yeah. So it is actually very easy to understand this chart. So if we have visions and values, we feel in communication, it has to be set up in a certain structure. We need processes to implement that. We need all the co-workers who are committed to live that, to implement that, to sell the products you are selling, especially in the pharma industry, in the medtech, in whatever branch you are, in whatever sector you are. And this is to be seen in actions like turnover, what image does the company have outside, and so on and so on. Yeah. So this is the base on what that integral is to be seen. Now, of course, we have also the cultural aspect. Culture, one of the most known people who have who did in research was Mr. Hofstede. There is a much more sound study, which is called the GLOBE study, where we have different dimensions, which are important when we look at culture in different countries. Yeah, we have all these points like power, distance, individualism, masculinity. Individualism means we'll be talking about, are we talking about an individual country where you would like to invest, or are we talking about a collectivistic country you would like to invest? Because this has a tremendous impact on how you set up your structures in another country. Yeah, and I'll show you an example in the next slide what I mean. Do we have, for example, uncertainty avoidance? I think it is known in general, the red line through Germany is that we have loads of risk management. What happens if we have in 5, in 10 years, in 15 years, this incident? Yeah. Now, there are many, many countries like India, but it's not only India. There are all these collectivistic countries, especially those who are more based in philosophies than in religion itself. They rather say, I don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. I cannot do a plan which is 2, 3, 4, 5 years old, depending on, of course, at the end, at the person you are talking to. Yeah. Long-term orientation, indulgence, and so on. Sometimes we have to be careful with these numbers. It's just a model to have an idea, where am I going to, but don't stick on always, don't take it as given that all the numbers and what they are showing is right, because your own experience is the most important thing. And culture is one dimension, but the individuality of a person is also very important to look at. Yeah, that is whatever I emphasize when I do intercultural trainings or I do intercultural consultancy, especially in connection with organizational development. Yeah. So looking at the power distance and especially also at the point individualism, I have this chart here. If you look at individualism, we can say that like the most individualistic country is the US, but Germany is not that far away. Yeah, what does it mean? It means that this individual here in the middle, all of us who is sitting here, who are watching right now, and the whole population are the red line through a country. The smallest entity in this societies is the individual. Yeah, that means he or she can form his or her surrounding according his or her needs. It's very common to say, if I don't get along, for example, with my own family, for example, with my sibling, I can decide who I can have as a friend, and I decide who is the closest to me. Yeah, so. And in individualistic countries, the focus on upbringing is more to become as soon and as fast independent as possible. And in collectivistic countries, a little bit different. I'm going through that very fast right now. Because in collectivistic countries, the self is also individual, of course. But in order to serve the community in general, the red line, and there are many countries that where it's changing, but if you look especially at the rural areas, the individual has to step back in order to serve the community. And if a person and if a society is built up like that, it has, of course, an impact on how to do business in multinational companies, and especially when two different societal systems or people coming together from two different societal systems, especially like individual and collectivism, this will have an impact on your business, of course. Yeah. So this is important to understand, because the focus on collectivistic countries in the upbringing is not becoming independent as fast as possible. It is a different definition of independence. Don't misunderstand me if I say that people in collectivistic countries are not independent, but it's more the focus of being able to communicate and live in a society. Yeah, it's not to say that the Chinese and the Indians are not independent, but the definition is very different. That's why I always emphasize very much in the beginning, especially when we have team trainings, that if you define, or if you say, yeah, we would like to respect everyone, I said we all have to find a common definition for respect right now, because person A has a different, coming from country A, has a different definition of respect than person B, coming from country B, has a definition of respect. And that means we have to form, if that comes into the organization. So the organization has to build up a new identity to say, okay, and this is a very common discussion we always have, that now we are a German company or we are an Indian company. They have to understand that if we set up an entity in India, for example, the Indians have to understand that these are the values. I said no. And the other way around is also that if this is 100% German entity in India, how much German culture can I bring in? And how much Indian culture do I have to also accept? And this is something where this understanding has to come. And therefore, I find also to coach and especially the leadership has to be coached there, because these are the decision makers on both sides. And then to accompany them and say, okay, there are many worldviews and these worldviews have to merge. That's how I see the world. Yeah. So if we look at the impacts of the cultural dimensions on an Indo-German corporation. Now, you've seen, I've extra taken this picture, which we have seen in the beginning, that there where we have looked at from a meta perspective on this subject, on a company, where you see that from outside, from the meta perspective, that these are the important points. There are many, many more to look at, especially to look at it in an individualistic manner. So if we have, for example, a matrix organization, yeah, that is in Germany with already developed we feeling and leadership styles, what does matrix organization mean? You don't have hierarchies at the end anymore. Kind of hierarchies, but not as in collectivistic structures. Yeah. So if you have people who work together from Brazil, India, China, and have only their own decision-making structures, but then have to report under certain, turnovers or results towards someone who has a higher designation. Yeah. In contrary to someone who's born and brought up in a hierarchical way, and even the company is living that hierarchical system, the question at the end is, how can these different mindsets, what we've talked about, because hierarchy is typical for collectivistic countries, and nowadays matrix organization, and even in Germany we still have loads of hierarchies, but the organization is very often organized in a matrix organogram. So how can these two mindsets fit together? And therefore, of course, you need to develop a new and individual culture with common vision and mission. And of course, adjustment, forming of individual structures and processes. So that would mean that's a birth of a new entity with its own vision, mission, structures, and whatever is needed, which has to be looked at individually. Yeah. So in my general experience, what I have in the last 20 years, this is one of the most essential things. And one of these points, which I have not yet introduced because it would also be too long right now to explain. What I've not mentioned here, I said equal means all quadrants, all levels, and all lines. I have not explained to you the levels yet. So the human mind has developed. I mean, we all know that, especially when we look how long does the human being exist. So even the evolution of the consciousness has developed. And this can be, for example, seen with the baby which is born. You were a baby, for example, and nowadays, and what your consciousness was as a baby, if you remember, but as a child, you remember. And now your consciousness has, of course, within all these years, it has developed. And the question is, how can this be that from a baby to a big, to a person, to an adult, we can have such a complex way of thinking? And this is actually the same thing we can have a look at organizations. On which levels are they right now? Where would they like to go? And each line has to be defined according the wishes, according the needs. Which line is right now important for your cooperation or your thoughts when you go to India? Or if not yet thought about it at all, why do you want to go there? And what benefits, independently from the marketing lines, which are to be seen also in the left bottom quadrant and left, because you have internal marketing and you have external marketing, of course. Yeah. So all these lines have to be really aligned in a way that a new company can be formed, a new, and you have a quite relaxing way of communication. And very important thing is also to understand how to resolve conflicts, because we all are very shy of having conflicts. But this is, from my opinion, and even researchers nowadays say that, that if you really want to emerge something new or develop something new, we cannot find solution with the mindset of the last century for the new centuries, especially if we are looking at 2050, where everyone says till then, this has to happen. And doing that together with economics and politics is very important. And I think even starting from the scratch, looking at that is when you go into a venture, it is very, very important to have a look at such points, especially if you want to be, everyone has this buzzword sustainable, but what does sustainable really mean? It just does, should not only mean that we have our own profits, that we have our own lifespan and not looking for the future generations. So all that, what we already have, and that's why, again, I'm coming back to the beginning, I have initiated the wisdom workshop where especially the Eastern and the Western wisdoms can come together, because even the Western wisdom is very old, ancient, and has loads of valuable inputs, which are actually nearly the same as the Eastern ones. We always differentiate. This model helps not to separate, it helps to merge. And that's what I live for, to understand that everything needs to merge now and not to see it as a separate, and even especially very, very much in business. That was my input from my side, a short insight into the integral organizational development. It is actually much more complex, but in the given time, I thought these were the most important things.
Yeah, wonderful, Purvi.
Thank you.
I am again grateful to Mova and Utkarsha, you know, for bringing you on board, and of course to you for this, you know, exciting presentation. Thank you all. I have some questions, Purvi. I think it is quite important and relevant, you know, even more now. We have seen the pandemic, you know, going nowhere. Maybe we will have, you know, few months, 1 year of extended lockdown. Nobody knows. And I think this mindset, you know, I think which you mentioned, and, you know, collective individualism, I just wanted to reflect upon how do you see as a coach, as a mentor in last 1 year, what has really changed? You know, have we become more submissive? Have we moved from individualism to collective because we have no other choice? So I just wanted to have your thoughts, Purvi, and also request audience if they have any questions.
Yeah, sure. Well, it's a very nice question. Thank you, Kuntal. It is, I think there is also a difference if we have, I would like to differentiate that between collectivism on with hierarchical thinking or collectivism on eye level thinking. These are two different consciousness of minds. Yeah. So this really has to be Now, if I look at Germany, last year I was really lucky to come back from India on 15th of March. So that was the last time I stepped into India. So since then, I was not able to travel. But I see, of course, a very big mind shift. And the pandemic has led, especially in Germany. And we also have to look in which surroundings are we living, you know? So since I'm very much interested and eager to get to learn more about that, so I used the time the last year to get more trainings in all these aspects and more deeper trainings. I think there is a mind shift because people have understood that it is not possible to look at the only individualistic needs and greeds. And I think the pandemic is actually to be seen as a chance and not to be seen as a negative thing, because it forms our resilience. And I think resilience is right now the one of the terms which is really important to each individual, because I believe if each individual learns to cope with stress, with uncertainty. And I think, for example, India is much better in dealing with uncertainty than for example, an individualistic country. But still, we have to, even anyone in the world has to learn, because we all are in stress, and India is moving towards more individualistic country that we should also not forget. So facing the same issues in a different way, but what even after wartime Europe has experienced, yeah. So I think it is not an answer to be given. The most important thing right now is resilience and to understand how actually oneself functions in order to have a good impact in an organization to others. That's like what
wonderful.
I would say.
Yeah. I think it sounds very, very interesting. You know, I was really intrigued by your thoughts and the presentation. I would also request our audience, you know, of course, the German audience, you know, it's a German book. If people really go and get the book, I would be curious to get that book as well. And Purvi, we would really love to be in touch through Pharma Circuit platform, you know, and as you have seen that we have declared today that we'll be coming out with a mentoring platform. And I think you will be one of our, collaborators, you know, if I may say so. Yeah. So, yeah, we will see, you know, still we are having baby steps. It's still too early. But, yeah, it is great to have you again and looking forward to, you know, the networking sessions and being in touch, Purvi. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much for this opportunity. Again, also to everyone who organizes that. And you have created something really wonderful. And keep going.
Thank you. Yeah, have a nice day and see you again very soon in one of our future conferences.
Yes. Bye-bye. Thank you. Have a good day then.
Have a nice day.
Bye.